Dr. Martin Gorman as this evening's speaker. Dr. Gorman received his training in dentistry at Temple University and had additional training in bioesthetics at the Lee Institute in San Francisco. He is a fellow of the International Congress of Oral Implantology, the International Academy of Dental Facial Aesthetics, and the American Academy of Oronathic. Boy, that's a new word for me, bioesthetics. So, Dr. Gorman, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you all for coming, and what I'm going to do is just a little bit of my background, a little more extensive than we just heard. Does anyone here know what bioesthetics is? Okay. Well, bioesthetics is basically the study of nature and the ideal form that nature gives people and all beings. And what actually Dr. Lee, who developed the bioesthetic philosophy, studied, was on staff here, right by here at Loma Linda University. And what he did, he noticed in his practice that all the people with the best teeth had all the exact same things in common. They had so much of a vertical and horizontal overbite, their jaw was in a certain position, and they chewed vertically. And he noticed that all these people, he said, had the best teeth, had very little wear, very little breakdown, very little dentistry was ever done to them. So what he started doing was to take people that were broken down, where their restorations and their teeth kept breaking and falling apart, and he gave them what he called his bioesthetic principles when he restored their mouths. And what happened was these people never had any problems with their teeth after that. That's how I really got my start to where I am today. Because of that knowledge and the questioning of what's happening, why is it happening, what can we do about it, answering those three questions has led me on this journey the last 18 to 20 years. Whereas I've been a dentist for 36, 37 years, but it's only since like in the early 90s when I started being one of Bob Lee's, he became my mentor, that I really learned what's happening, how we can really help people. And the big thing with bioesthetics and the way we treat our patients, or try to treat our patients, is we're really treating them to optimal health. And we're not just repairing their teeth, we're answering the middle question. What's happening? Because what's happening is going to give you the cause, is answer the cause of the problem. Why are things happening? And to fix an issue, whether it's a medical issue or a dental issue, by just going from what's happening to what can we do about it, things keep failing, breaking, and falling apart, whether it's in medicine or in dentistry or any walk of life. So I just want to give you a little explanation of where I'm coming from over the last 18 or 20 years, and that's really how it's changed the way we see our patients and the way we treat our patients, because we want to treat them toward health, not just get rid of the disease at that moment in time. Okay. Let's see. Yes. Oh, here we go. So our goals today and objectives for the presentation today is to learn effective ways to diagnose often overlooked disorders, to use new technology to help us form our treatment plans and assess our patients' health, and stimulate awareness and prevention with sleep and breathing issues and TMJ and TMD issues. Because these two are pretty much the most overlooked areas in healthcare today, sleep and TMJ. As I said, treating to health is health-based dentistry. And as I said earlier, the biggest areas of growth in healthcare today and in dentistry is in facial pain, sleep apnea, and temporomandibular dysfunction. We have many patients that seek us out, and they come in with these long histories of being to multiple doctors, multiple dentists, and never getting a solution to their issues, because they have something that's not being looked for. And we're going to go over how we can screen our patients to find out if they have these disorders. So in our practice, we see patients that have worn teeth. Basically, anyone that has wear we see people, we want to screen people who break their teeth a lot. Their crowns, porcelain breaks, crowns break off, bridges fail, implants fail. They have bite issues. They have some form of TMJ. And a lot of people with facial pain, jaw pain, joint pain, migraine pains, that are all associated with TMJ. And then people that have a lot of stress or fatigue, snoring and breathing disorders. Snoring is the first sign, it's actually the second sign. The first sign is upper airway resistance syndrome, which is like restless breathing. Next step is snoring, and then you get into sleep apnea. But in most cases, it's progressive. And I know because I went through it. I started out with restless breathing, moved into a little bit of snoring, and at that point I said, enough's enough, and I've been being treated since, and I don't have any issues any longer. And something very interesting here is patients with narrow faces or narrow upper dental arches. This is really very easy to diagnose on people in our practices, because in most of the industrialized countries, capitalized countries in the world, narrow faces is a standard. But if you look into Africa and the tribal regions and South America, native tribes, they all have these big round faces. And these big round faces mean they have really wide middle thirds of their face. And the middle third of the face is your maxilla, your upper jaw, and associated bones. And the reason, there are two theories that are being proposed of why Americans and capitalized and other capitalized countries have narrow faces, is that our middle third of our face aren't growing to the genetic potential. And the reason they're not growing is there's two factors. One is the chemistry in our foods, and there's several studies out there prove that. And the other theory is on, bottle feeding versus breastfeeding, and then use of pacifiers and thumb sucking. You put a pacifier under the thumb in someone's mouth, it forces the palate up, and you end up with a narrow upper dental arch. And the same thing happens with bottles, and that all started in the early 1900s with bottle feeding. And it's since that time that we've developed narrow faces. And the chemistry of the foods also, like I said. So there's two big theories out there, and they both make a lot of sense to me. So that's very easy to screen. So what are we doing? In our practice, what we do is we have these standard forms, just a regular health history form from one of the, any company that prints them up. It gives a basic, it's fairly comprehensive, gives a basic idea of what's going on. And then we do have an Epworth sleepiness scale form, a generalized sleep apnea questionnaire, stop bang questionnaire, which is about sleep also, a TMJ questionnaire, and we take patient photos. So we gather this information as a first phase. And what we're going to do is we're going to show you some, here we go. And this is just a standard health history form. Who do we get this, Maria?
Top
data.
Form.
Yeah, but it's very comprehensive, and when you see this, then you can take out the second layer, which would be like this Epworth sleepiness scale. And what you want to be is, if you have a score above eight or greater, based on the point system, patient circles, you add the numbers up. If they're eight or greater, they should have an issue, some sleep or breathing issue. What we also do, this questionnaire is one that it's very easy. It's a point and click or circle and count. The patient reads, circles, anything that applies to them, they circle. All these forms are available on my website, or you may have some samples here. You can call my office and we can get them to you. But this is a very basic form that five or greater, five more symptoms may have an issue with obstructive sleep apnea. Okay? Next, this is something new we've just added. And actually, actually Laley put this one together for us. This is the Malapati scale, where the patient sticks their tongue out, says ah, and you can see the back of the throat, and the more the back throat is covered, all you end up seeing is the heart, the roof of the mouth of the heart palate. It's class four. The more you tend to class four, the greater the chance is an issue with a breathing issue. And then the stop bang part is stop stands for snoring, tiredness, observe stop breathing, and blood pressure issues. Bang is BMI greater than 35, age greater than 50, neck circumference, and male gender. So this is really, really easy to screen a patient with. And we actually have these two forms from back to back, same sheet of paper. Okay? And it's real simple. And we usually give this form to TMJ patients that come into the practice and they have pain and discomfort. And when I finish the TMJ screening, I go, how are you sleeping? And they go, sleep? I don't sleep. I haven't slept in 20 years. So then we give them this two-sided sheet. So it's really amazing when you ask questions to patients, the answers you get. It's just another TMJ form where the patients fill in the frequency, intensity, they diagram their issues. And then there's another TMJ questionnaire. And this one, they just circle any of the symptoms they may or may not have. So it's a little bit easier. And sometimes some patient, we have to actually have one of my staff go in the reception room and sit there and go over with the patient so they can, you know, feel comfortable and get everything correct. Okay, what we're going to do next is the photos. And this is very interesting. And if you really want to, and I'm just starting to really analyze and see things in photos, full-face photos and tooth photos of our patients. I took this program up in through Arrowhead Dental Lab. They're in Sandy, Utah. And we'll get into, you know, more of what that whole program is about. But there's a dentist, his name is Dr. Dave Singh, S-I-N-G-H. He's up in Portland. And he has an institute up there. And he can look at someone's face and tell you what's all the bones, anything that's wrong, what's right, what's different. So when you look at a facial picture like this, there's really a lot going on. And we're not just taking pictures, you know, to waste film in the old days and to take up, you know, space on a memory card. So this woman came into us with TMJ issues, and this arrow signifies this earlobe. Big difference in the height of her ears. Here, her masseter is much larger than on this side. Her sternocleidal masseter is very, very intense here compared to here. And then here, too, is a big difference in this space. So the pictures tell us a lot what's going on. Okay? And they're very, very informative. And we didn't get a clearance to use her picture, but if you saw her eyes, her eyes aren't level, and they're very, very tired looking. A lot of strain, a lot of stress in them. This one's really obvious. Eye level, up by half an inch. It's huge. Her whole facial symmetry is off. Her lips, her eyebrows, her ears. There's a lot of issues this woman has with TMJ and sleep. She's a combination patient. This gentleman, very interesting, he works for a sleep lab where they have take-home sleep tests. And you can see here too, the eyes are definitely off, midline, canted, lips, ears. Extremely narrow face. Now he's a very good athlete. Like the fact that he built up his aerobic capacity, he has a mild sleep issue. noticed in a handful of patients, and actually I'll show you, later on you see some x-rays of my son, and he's a pretty good, he's a fair athlete, but he runs around and is very active. And he has issues, but a lot of them are put in the back burner because he has worked out so much running and weightlifting that he has been able to overcome a lot of the disabilities that he really has. Okay. And then we have what's called malocclusion. It's a bad bite. This is something that came into our practice very recently. But, and it's not just the bite that's bad. You can see all the recession at the gum lines, fillings. Look at the length of this tooth versus this tooth. There's not 100%, but a fairly high percentage on teeth that have some form of gum recession. There's usually some form of bite problem, a little extra pressure on the tooth, the crown, something in lateral excursion isn't passing correctly, and you end up with things like this happening all over the mouth. Okay. So what we have now is, like I said earlier, the reason we have so many forms when people come in is because so many people misdiagnose. I said, when I have a patient coming in to see me, and they've been to a myriad of doctors and dentists and physical therapists and chiropractors, and they've never had it, no one's ever found what's wrong with them, I know they have TMJ, or TMJ and a sleep issue. They've had every MRI, everything has been done to them, and everything is fine. But it's very misdiagnosed, especially TMJ in the medical dental community today. And a lot of the comorbidities are not linked to sleep or TMJ. And one of the problems is tests used to diagnose these conditions are expensive and specialized. For example, if you want to get an MRI or a cone beam or an MRI or a CAT scan at a medical lab, it's really, really expensive. But if you're a dentist or a doctor, you can buy a dental-grade cone beam. And they're expensive, but you can do the service for probably a quarter of the price that a medical lab would charge. So things are coming down, but you have to be willing to kind of go out there and invest in the new technology. Okay. So what we're going to do is we can get beyond the basics, maybe. And the state-of-the-art equipment that we use in our practice. We have a Kodak 93-inch cone beam x-ray. And there's a lot of good ones out there. The reason we chose this one was the radiation levels are either first or second lowest radiation. And it's probably about 1/10 the radiation of a medical grade cone beam, medical grade x-ray. And with the Kodak, you can take regional pictures. So you want to just take the lower jaw, the upper jaw, left side, right side, just the TMJs. You can do all these smaller pictures. So really much low radiation for the patient. And then we have the pharyngometer test, which measures with acoustic waves, measures the oral airways. Rhinometer measures the nasal passages. And then joint vibration analysis is a piece of equipment that put headphones on, open and close, move around, gives you all the range of motion, gives you any noises in the joint, and tells you, you see where the noise is, if it's an early noise, middle noise, late noise, it really calibrates everything for you. And not everything's 100% accurate. It just gives you more of an idea what's happening, and the more information you get, the better diagnosis and treatment you can give your patients. And the last one is a text scan bite analysis. And just a little story. On this one, I actually bought it probably over 20 years ago when it first came out, and we didn't like it, so I gave it back. And then I was at a program down in San Diego, and they had it, and we tried it again, and I had my whole staff with me at this particular course, and two of the people, my staff people, named therapy, went through this whole long process, took like a year to do each case. And bit by bit, you sit there and they close their teeth together, their eyes are closed, they're concentrating, they're focusing, to make sure everything is perfect. And they felt everything was great. Well, I put them on tech scan at this program, and they both came up with prematurities on their second molars. We made the adjustments, and they go, wow, that feels so much better. So I said, that's when I bought it, and I've been using it ever since. And it's a fabulous diagnostic tool. Okay. Benefits of cone beam, it's really, if you take a full picture, there's many different, like this Kodak 9300 is a large and a small version. You can get it from here to the eyebrow level, to the lower, through the lower jaw. The one we got, because we do sleep dentistry, is I got the large one so I can get the airways. So it goes from the airway to the top of the eye. And you get the TMJ joints, you can use your implant placement, you can find tumors and cysts, and you can find calcified arteries. Now, and this is just a basic, what we get from beam readers up in Sacramento. We send all our scans to be read. I'm not a medical radiologist, so I'm not qualified to do a reading and find anything, so it's really a major liability not to have every scan read by a professional radiologist. So everyone gets emailed out and gets, you know, sent back to us. We get a two, three, four page report depending on the individual patient. And they just, you know, they always have, they format a Panorex and they show you the TMJ joints. They give you the different angles of the sinuses and just all these different pictures. There's the nerve, you know, different things. And they show you, and they give you a full report. We'll look at some of them in a few minutes. The one negative, this is a normal TMJ scan. Normal condyles, cortical plate. Here at this angle, it's really centered nicely. And the fossa, looks really nice. The one problem I have with the software is these numbers carry forward from screen to screen when you change the screens you're looking at. And these numbers have nothing to do with this picture. So just ignore them. But I needed them for something else, so I didn't want to erase them too long. Anyway, but it's really very easy software to use. And this is actually the same slide, I'm sorry. Okay, now here's a TMJ tumor. And you saw the normal's nice and round, and here's his growth. And this gentleman actually had a, was hit by a bus or a cab. When he was actually a musician, he was on tour in Canada. He was standing on the curb, and he got hit by a car or a bus or a truck, and he's been in pain, you know, he was in pain for 20 years, and came to see me, and we helped with his TMJ, but the problem he had was with this extension here. This tumor is, it changes the muscle attachment, and it changes the way the bone moves, so it changes the way the muscles work. So the only way to really fix this is to go in and do some form of surgery to reshape the condyle and reattach the muscles correctly. But we can get this information. And this one here is just a different angle. So you're really cutting through here. That's why there's a space there. Here's another variant. This was an auto accident case that was sent to us. And the patient was fine for the first 4 or 5 months after the accident. She had a little minor, little aches and pain, but nothing crazy. And all of a sudden, she's developing all these headache and facial pain. So the attorney sends it to us, and we take the cone beam. And this is a bone growth that came about, and we sent it to the beam readers. They said it was post-traumatic bone growth. And I'll show you the report later on. And here's another angle of the same thing. And we're very lucky with this young lady. We were actually able to get her completely out of pain. But when you have changes in anatomy like this, you don't know if you're getting a good result or a bad result. And here's, right here, left TMJ consists with post. airways, and they give you, you know, their impressions at the end. It's really a very comprehensive report from beam readers. These are normal airways, and I think this is my son. It's hard to tell him. He doesn't have his hat on. Okay, what this measurement is here is 36.4, I think. Is that what it says? Yes, 36.4. And it's basically first molar to first molar. And that's one of the things with Dr. Dave Singh with his program is that he found that the average from first molar to first molar on the average healthy person was 38 to 42 millimeters. And most people that have narrow upper jaws, narrow faces, middle third of the faces, they're in the 32, 30, 31. I have people 28 millimeters. But usually most of our patients are 31, 32, 33. To be at, you know, 36.4 is pretty close to 38. And then this is his pharynx, and he's at 35.8. And anything over 25, 26, 27 is really pretty good. So he has really big airway here, even though he is definitely narrow. You know, if I put his picture up, he's kind of narrow like I am, a little bit narrow. And we use this information to help determine if there's a sleep issue and to see what treatment we can render, because there's many options, especially with young people. Here, these are his inferior turbinates down here.
Yeah.
And the measurement is 5.3. Anything over 3.5 is really good airway space with the inferior turbinate area. Most people come in, it's like 0.5 to 1 millimeter maximum. The turbinates are almost touching the adjacent bone here. Airway, and you can see the numbers of 13.3 and 16.7. The 16.7 is really, really good. Anything over 12 is considered pretty decent. And this is 13.3, and that's with his soft palate and uvula hanging down here. I'll show you some cases where the uvula and soft palate are so large, it literally blocks the entire airway. So what I've done is this scan, we've only had it for about 1.5 years, but it's really totally changed the way we practice. Because the information like this that we get, if I'm making someone a dental appliance for their sleep, well, here, if they need something, if the soft palate needs are totally blocking the airway, and I'm going to move their jaw 3.5 millimeters forward, and that gives them 6.5 or 7 millimeters of airspace, well, you need 10 or 12. So what are you making the appliance for? It's not going to work. So we refer that patient out for different treatment or recommend a different option. And now this is interesting. This girl, she came as a TMJ patient, but we took the comb to check her condyles, and she had already had inferior turbinate surgery. She had her turbinates removed, and when I asked her about it, she goes, "I've never breathed better." She said it was night and day difference from before surgery to after. Now, and we have had one patient in our practice, he's a sophomore junior at the University of Arizona, and he did the same thing. And the problem, it works great. The only problem is, postoperatively, it took him over 1 month to recover. And he ended up missing a semester of school. Because he took it toward the end of, like, 3 weeks, 3 or 4, they said he'd be fine in 2-3 weeks. And he wasn't fine for 4, 5, 6 weeks. But it worked. Feels great. Fabulous procedure. And here is just a large, healthy airway. And here is an apneic airway. Look at those numbers. If I made her an appliance to move her we sent everyone to be read, and all of a sudden, over the last 2 months, we've had three patients come in that their Cohen beams showed calcified carotid arteries. Okay, and that's a much more serious issue. It's a real serious issue. So we refer them right to the general practitioner, the MDs, and they seek whatever treatment. But I'm not treating anybody with this. I don't know if letter of clearance from their MDs. And this is a apnea here. You can see how narrow that is. And it's not very wide either. So this is the kind of information we want to gather. And this is what I was saying earlier regarding inferior turbinates. See how close they are to the bone? The airway's maybe it's a half a millimeter. And actually down in here, it's almost non-existent. You can't breathe. And you'll never get this information just with a visual type exam. What we have here is the report we got on the last handful of slides. Predispose the patient at moderate to high risk for the development of obstructive apnea. Narrow joint spaces, which I didn't really show you, but this is why we know at the scan that she has TMJ, because of the position of her condyles, that she could have a disc perforation. So treating her with a traditional dental appliance would be the worst thing we could ever do for her. Or for us, she may be happy with it, but we'd have problems. And then osteoarthritis and spine. This is a very, very common finding, by the way. Probably half the people over 50 have some form of osteoarthritis in the cervical spines. And then the carotid arteries. So it's a very comprehensive report. Now, this is something really interesting, and this is what has really helped change the way we treat our patients and to do better service for them. You see the numbers are really small, 6, 4, 8. But if the soft palate and uvula weren't there, it goes to 12.2. So this patient, I can't make this 4.8. I can't get it up to 10, 11, or 12 with a dental appliance. You have to use some kind of CPAP or some modification of a CPAP to do that. But if they removed the soft palate and uvula, now you have a pretty decent airway, and then you still might need a little bit of movement down here. But all these would go to 10, 11, 12, 13 millimeters. And then if you gave an oral appliance or something really simple to move the jaw forward somewhat, you'd probably have a really good result. But without doing surgery here, there's no way that this is going to work. So we're actually doing less treatment at times, because now we can see our treatment's not going to be successful. So our success rate's gone up because we're not treating the patients that we realize we cannot help. Here's another one. And you can look at the size of that. Look at that. Now, I don't have a number of measurements here for you, but you can see these airways are huge if the soft palate was taken out. So we didn't treat this patient either. And this is, oh yes, yeah, really good one. Here's a gentleman with his entire sinus is blocked up. Deviated septum. No communication at all on this side. And he thinks he's breathing good. Goes to his doctor all the time. Everything's fine. And what we do is, with patients that we have to send to the doctor, we actually give them a copy of the radiology report, and we burn a copy of their cone beam. And they get a copy of the cone beam and a copy of the radiology report to take their MDs with them. Here's another one, another calcified carotid artery. And this one actually is someone I've known for 35, 36 years. He was a teacher with my wife at this elementary school in Los Angeles. And he's a surfer in shape, really great guy. And but there was something came up, and I was like, my hygienist saw it and said, you know, Dr. Gorman, something with good Mike is not right. Something that, I said, okay. So she tells me, she says, I think you're right. So he said, I don't want to take this x-ray today. I'll come back next time. I said, fine. Come back next time. We take this, and boom. Calcified carotid. Because he's been having, he had a little TIA. That's what piqued our interest, piqued my hygienist's interest. And when I heard that, I said, with his, when I started medical history, they changed that. I said, yeah, we need to do this. So, and we haven't, we sent him off to his MD. We haven't, it's only like three or four weeks ago. So we haven't communicated since. And this is just shows the report, what it looks like, and another angle of someone with a totally opacified maxillary sinus, and the other side is looks about 35-40% blocked also. And being a dentist, we've had a couple of cases over the years where before we got the cone beam, that people come and say, yeah, my sinus is driving me crazy. I'm going to this sinus doctor, that sinus doctor, and no one can fix anything. And then if you look at their x-rays, they have, you know, they have root canals in every tooth on the upper, from, you know, 25, 30 years ago. They have these issues, they have the teeth, the periodontal issues, the roots are close to the sinus, close to the sinus. And we had already restored her lower teeth biostatically and modified her upper teeth to work, made the changes so I could give her an ideal lower arch. And that was like, I don't know, 15 years ago. And so finally, the upper teeth are failing, it's partially made, it's falling apart, and blah, blah, blah. So we finally take her teeth out. And within 6 weeks after all her teeth coming out and getting a temporary denture, all her sinus issues went away. So there's a real major communication that we have between broken down teeth and sinus issues. I'm not so sure on this side here, but these with the root canals is a good chance that has something to do with this inflammation in that sinus. And this is another shot that they would give us of the different slices through the condyles, both angles, and then another calcified carotid artery. So I'm learning every time, not every case, but they're, you know, one a month probably that comes back a little bit different. And if I have to, I get on the phone with beam readers and the radiologist that deals with that. It's funny, beam readers really grown over the last handful of years because so many dentists are getting cone beams. So I was getting a different radiologist reading my scans every time. So I said, I call him, I want one person. I want to know what I'm getting, I want the consistency, I want to know who's doing it. So we chose one. So now I have someone I can contact and you can build a little bit of a relationship with. But it's been an adventure learning and looking for things that you know what I want to look for. But no matter how much I know and how well I can read it, I would still send it out, like I say, because of liability reasons. Okay. And you can see here it comes back. Moderate chronic pain, or whatever it is, severe chronic rhinosinusitis, osteoarthritis again, and then the carotid artery. But this we see all the time, osteoarthritis and cervical vertebrae. And that's another view of calcified carotid arteries on the beam reader report. Okay. This piece of equipment was probably the first one we really brought in. We may have had the JBA, the TMJ analysis piece of software first. This may have been the second piece, or when we realized there was a really major connection between sleep and TMJ. I think we see probably about two-thirds of the patients that come in to see us, they have both. They have TMJ issues and they have sleep issues. And what this pharyngometer does to see, and this is a found-out result. The green is the baseline. By baseline, what we mean is that's just the patient breathing into the machine, standing up on their own, just breathing normally, and we get their breathing curve. And then the collapse, what we're trying to do is have the patient collapse their airway to mimic when they're sleeping. And some people do it better than others. The older they get, the tougher it is to get it, do it real accurately. Sorry, Sage. And then the machine graphs it and measures. So in this case, the collapse, it only collapsed to 70% of original size. And anything over 70% is within normal range. So if someone's airway collapses only to 70%, that's good. But the problem with the statistic is, what if the airway's too small to begin with and it collapses to 70%? Well, now you have 70% of something that was too small to begin with. Now, if it was a really big airway and it collapses to 70%, that patient's probably pretty okay. But there's a lot of variations. And it's a little sidebar. I don't know how many here do sleep dentistry. No one? Okay. Well, when you get a sleep test back from a sleep lab, one of the issues, they give you this number AHI, apnea hypopnea index. And apnea is a total stoppage of breathing for 10 seconds or longer. Hypopnea is a 3 or 4% drop in oxygen level over a 10-second period. And you could have, people come out, people with 70A and 90 AHIs total between the two. And people go with 25, 30, 15, 10, 5, whatever. It's a wide range. But the point I'm trying to make is, I'll make them an appliance, and then we'll do a post-op sleep test. And the patient says, I feel great, I have all my energy back, I'm sleeping fabulous, not getting thrown to the bathroom all the time. My wife says that I'm snoring more, I'm quiet as a church mouse, blah, 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 blah. The test comes back, and they're the same AHI. They're right at 25 again. They still 25 when they started, 25 when they ended. So what's happening is that number doesn't differentiate between A and H. You can have 20 A's, 5 H's in the pretest, and have the reverse in the post-test. That's a lot more oxygen coming into that patient, even though the numbers are the same. That's number one. Number two, you have an issue with the length of time. This is just, it's 10 seconds or longer. So all your events in the pretest could be 25 seconds each event. And in the post-test, they all could be 11 or 12 seconds. So your total time without oxygen has really gone down substantially. But this field is really so new. We have all these kinks to iron out. And at this point, I'm trying to get my diplomat status with the American Academy of Sleep Medicine. And I've talked to other dentists, and they go, the biggest problem you have is getting 10 cases that the patient drops from X to under 10 events. And we have all these patients that are successful. They feel great. But when we give them the sleep test, ask them, their AHI is still above 10 or very close to where they started, but they feel great. And then I said to them, well, it's because of what I just explained to you. There's no differentiation in the numbers. There's no differentiation in the amount of time. And now we're seeing more of these sleep tests coming in with total time of each, and not so much. They'll give you a number, AHI, but they'll give you also the amount of minutes and seconds. And you'll see this huge variation from the pre-test to the post-test. So it's a very young field, and there's a lot of things that just aren't set up well yet. Okay, so that's the pharyngoma that we did around our arm. Okay, good now. Okay, now here's one, 25.3. So this airway collapsed down to 25% of its original size. But like I said, you don't know how accurate it is. It's just another test result that gives us some idea what might be happening. These are the rhinometers, and these horizontal gray lines are where the airflow should be above. So if you look at the right nostril air passage, just right at the minimum size. So it's just information you have to pull together that helps you make a better diagnosis. Here's another rhinometer. Here, the left side is great, and the right side wasn't so good, but just barely average. Okay, this is really a cool tool. There's a lot of cool tools in dentistry. Joint fibrillation analysis. Sorry. Put the headgear onto the little microphones, right on the joints. You have your computer measure it, and after this is on, the patient puts his headgear on, and it measures all the ranges of motion. Your vertical opening, your forward movement, left, right, and if there are any deviations. It measures noises, and it gives you the exact locations of noises, and it breaks up the noise in the hard and soft tissue. Obviously with TMJ, if there are noise and issues, you all want them all to be mostly soft tissue. Hard tissue noise is not really good, because the more hard tissue noise you have, the greater chance of some kind of perforation. And if it's a perforation, you have real major issues. So here's a patient with the headgear on, opening, and there's a little magnet placed in a certain position on the gums in front of the lower teeth, and it will measure all the different movements. And this is what we get. And this is a before treatment where the integrals the amount of noise and vibrations in the joint. The total on the left side was over 70, and we finished treatment was down under 30. And everything improved. And what you do is, I don't have the picture of it. You record the data, and you end up with six windows, six recordings, and you just deal with the average. And it's really a positive, especially for when you're treating a patient, they may feel good, but a lot of people really want to see statistics and see something in writing on a piece of paper that says, yeah, I really improved. And that's why we all, in most cases, we'll compare the pre and the post, and they'll see that they've improved tremendously. We actually had one patient that took almost a year and a half to stabilize his TM. Well, he was actually comfortable within a month, 100% comfortable. But his jaw kept moving, and the way we adjust our TMJ appliance a certain way, and we can tell that the jaw is still moving. And he had TMJ so long, he had so much inflammation and fluid buildup in his joints that when he was done with treatment after 6 months, we had him on a 90-day recall. He would come back in 90 days. I would check his appliance, and I adjusted it as if I had never adjusted the appliance before. He was totally out of pain, but the jaw kept moving. And it took four 90-day recalls before that fourth one with as little or no adjustment. And he wanted us to fix his teeth because he didn't like the way his teeth looked and they were beat up. But I said, we can't fix it until you stabilize. Because if you keep moving, your lower jaw moves, your lower teeth are going to move with it, your bite's going to change, and you're going to break your teeth. And he knew I was right, but he had to wait an extra year before he was ready. His body biologically was ready to accept dental treatment. Yes?
Could that be the Bennett shift?
Pardon?
The differences of the Bennett shift.
I can't hear.
The Bennett and shift.
Bennett shift. Biostatic dentistry, we actually use an articulator that you can change the condyles, not change the fosses, depending on the dent shift. But it really doesn't make a whole lot of
appliances.
Well, when we build our TMJ appliances, we get their up and down moves first, and then we add protrusive second, and then we add left and right as they heal up. And we adjust the canines. We start with the steep, see if they can adjust. They can't adjust. I keep opening up the angle, give more freedom. But you really want people to chew up and down, chew vertically. And we've changed the way people chew, hundreds of people. And they've gone from sideways chewers, wearing their teeth down, breaking everything, to vertical chewers. We make all our dentures with verticalized occlusion. And they learn to chew up and down. It's the only way the teeth are going to work. And it really help stabilize lower dentures to a point where the vast majority of people that we treat with that, we only give them mini implants on the lower arch. We don't give them real big implants. We give them 4 or 5 mini implants, and they just chew vertically, and the denture doesn't move. They're like thrilled. But the bene chip is a big deal. But you can't, you have to heal up the apparatus before you put that, deal with that. Okay. It's just, this is the graph I was talking about earlier, where these record the spikes in the different regions, and they end up coming down here, and you get your average. And there's a way to read them, and pretty complex. But what we end up doing is we use these JVA flow sheets, which, and there's multiple, there's probably half a dozen different ones. You know, anyone that's semi-famous makes their own. But none of them are really 100%, even remotely 100% accurate. But one thing that I will show you is, see here, at 10 times this waveform and this waveform, they're identical. And notice this one's normal. And that one is acute disc displacement, 4B, the pain, with the same waveform. And basically the reason is, in normal everything's nice and quiet and smooth, and here you're tending to the point where the cartilage is totally in front of the condyle almost all the time, and the retrodiscal tissue has been so damaged it's become scar tissue. So now it's just part of the disc, so the patient's out of pain, and everything's nice and smooth. They definitely have, you know, they'll have limited opening and limited left to right movements because the cartilage is in the wrong place, but they'll have the same waveform as a normal patient. That's why there's a lot going on, not just gathering the results, but understanding and figuring. Every time I go to a meeting and JVA is there, I sit down with them. They have manuals that show different graphs and all. And you never get one that looks like the book. You know, they give you the book with all the samples, and none of them ever match real patients. So, I mean, it really becomes pretty involved. It's an art to try to figure things out. That's why you take everything in, and you use your common sense and all the knowledge, all these different tests. Okay. All right. Text scan. I gave the story already about Sonda and Nancy with their bite, which is why I brought it back into the practice, and we use it all the time now. Every TMJ patient that comes in that wants to move ahead gets a cone beam and a TEC scan analysis. And the big thing here with TEC scan is, see, you have these spikes. And the big thing with TEC scan, it gives you the force of each articulating paper mark. When we put articulating paper in someone's mouth and we get this big smear, we say, oh, that's the problem. Look how big it is. But we don't know if it's big like this or big like this. And the same thing with small little point. Is it nothing just sitting there, or is it a real tap, a real hard point? So you don't know. We adjust because that's what we were trained to do, take out the big spots. But it's the little one that could be the problem. And the TEC scan gives you that information and gives you a really good location of where to adjust the teeth so you get the, so you can balance someone's bite. Okay, this is Laylee. Laylee, right here. And I forget when we did this, goes back about a year. And this is her TEC scan. 72% of her bite was on the right side. 28% on the left. This is the biggest discrepancy we've ever had. Let's check in. What are these numbers? 9, 2, 26, 7, 8, 0, 7, 4. You know, this is all on her right side. Number one and number two. See this dip here? That's the muscle maximum moving force, but it's the muscles. She was clenching. Well, we want you to close down on the sensor, and you have to hold your teeth tight together for 2 seconds, as hard as you can. Well, halfway through, she said, my muscles ain't working. They gave up because her muscles are sore and tired. So they give up. I've had people, it goes up like this, and just, they can't hold it for a couple seconds. muscles are tired. So not only do you get the analysis of the force and the location of all the issues with the bite where things are off, but it gives you an idea what's going on with the muscles. Okay, now we're going to experiment. Okay. Now, oh, there it goes. It's working on its own. Okay. This is a tech scan moving, and you see the numbers changing at the bottom, 35 on the right, and the left, and 65 on the other side. And I'm going to try to stop this.
Click it once.
There it is. Okay. So what this shows us, the bite force is pretty good, actually increasing all the way up. And what is not there anymore, but there was a red spot right here that was there and subsided. It's because things change. And you can play this one, two, three frames at a time, so you can actually see how the teeth are changing in their fit. But the big thing is it's 35 and 65. And you can see 16.9 versus 4.5, 22.7 versus 10. And that's why it's two-thirds over here. These teeth here are always killing it. And there's nothing going on in the front. So if we go to the next slide, here we go again. This is the after. And it's playing in the, okay. And now we're at 45, 55. And that's like the minimum you should achieve. But you see all the force? It's all these low colors. And you can see the graph down here with the blue. I mean, there's really nothing. But this hug paint, red, orange, brown, yellow, all that. And you really want to be mostly in here, which is all this stuff. And it's all low-level force. It's all really pretty even. Every once in a while, you'll get one. And it's really crazy. I mean, you look at this, you go in, you put your paper, and you get your marks, and you look at this, and you make your adjustments, and it's worse. You know, it's really, it flows. So all I can tell you is if you get one of these, just, you know, you get close, leave it, bring the patient back in a few weeks. Because remember, every time you adjust a tooth, we've all had patients that come in and go, I'm hitting over here. So you adjust them. You mark it, you adjust it. Yeah, it feels great. They call back 4 days later, I'm hitting over here. And that's an indication to me that the condyle's not seated. Up here. The condyle's not tight in the fossa. You change the bite, you adjust the bite, and the point it keeps shifting. That means that the jaw's not seated biologically in the socket. Okay? And I'll show you as we move, get further in the presentation, there's different adjustments we do to people. And some of the adjustments, if you, like, for example, if you use an appliance, all the adjustments are made in the appliance. So the condyle and the jaw is seated correctly. So when I go to adjust that patient's bite, it's not going to shift because they've already done all the work in the appliance. But if I start adjusting someone's bite without using an appliance, they're coming in at a predetermined schedule. They keep coming back because I know the jaw's going to move. But I'm hoping from the material we've gathered that it's a minor case. And the least expensive they can do to somebody is do tech scan and adjust their teeth, as opposed to putting them through an appliance for 15 or 20 visits. So we're always looking to do the least expensive, least invasive form of treatment. And sometimes some of the treatment is, when you just adjust someone's bite without treating with an appliance first, you're working almost like working backwards. Okay? All right. Why is all this data important? Talking about that for the last hour. Everyone okay?
Yep.
Everyone awake? Okay. So we have all this data, and this is a little, we all know Joe from Charles Dickens' Pickwickian syndrome. So they've known about snoring, obesity, sleepiness, and dropsy for a lot of years. It's been around. A little bit about dental sleep medicine. As I mentioned earlier, It's really probably the newest, most energized field in healthcare today. When you have 50 to 70 million people have some form of sleep-related breathing, and 89% of them are undiagnosed, that's pretty serious stuff. And I don't know what's going on down here, but in the San Fernando Valley, where I live in practice, they're building more and more homes with two master suites because of the snoring issue. And that's been going on for a long time. At least, I don't know, they remodeled and built this house on the corner from me. And you always, when a house goes up, you always go in and see what's going on, check the price, you figure what your house is worth and all that stuff. So, you know, went out there one Sunday, and they had two master suites. I said, what's this two master suite stuff? Because snoring, you know, but of course I treat that. But I didn't realize it was that severe that people really were demanding separate bedrooms. So it's not great. So we have snoring is first, really, an upper airway resistance syndrome, and then obstructive sleep apnea. And then there's, we'd like to, oral appliances are the big issue today is that it isn't just making an appliance and giving a patient a turn screw and seeing them every once in a while to make sure they're okay. There's really, it's a major deal with the fitting and adjustments and long-term follow-up. And there's so many issues with occlusion and TMJ and muscle pain. I had one myself, and I just had it set edge to edge. And every morning I woke up, I was like, and my muscles hurt. And I'd put my jaw back, I'd squeeze, I'd clench, I'd try to get right. And I said, it just hurt, a little dull ache. So I go out to breakfast, and you can chew, it doesn't matter where your teeth are, you just chew. So I had a little bit of breakfast, I go to the office, and finally by 10:30, it was all normal. And I said, you know, I can't deal with this crap. You know, it has to be a better way. And I'll show what one of the better ways is, as opposed to an oral advancement appliance, that you don't have to deal with those issues. Okay, sleep. Everyone knows how important sleep is. I've noticed a few of you have been sleeping here. So getting a jump start. Okay. Obviously it affects our daily function, concentration, alertness, performance, memory difficulties, learning, depression. Memory's really great. I don't remember what I did this morning. I do because it was a horrible morning. I remember. Okay, but memory's an issue. Daytime sleepiness, you know, falling asleep when you're in the passenger car, falling asleep in a movie, watching TV, reading a book. I've had people come in, I'm talking, we're discussing stuff, and they fall asleep in the chair. I mean, this is like 3 minutes into the visit. You know, and it's sleeping. So, I mean, there are some serious issues. And sleep is extremely important. Okay. This is really interesting. 50% higher for stroke, heart attack. 2 times more likely dying to sleep, motor vehicle accidents. There's $8 billion a year, billion. You can bring the budget down. Auto accidents. I mean, that alone, truck drivers, and you can't even get into them. People that drive don't want to be diagnosed because they don't want a CPAP, and they don't want an oral appliance, and they just want to keep driving. Truck drivers, I have a policeman comes to see us. So, I mean, thank God we're helping them. But they're out there all the time, and they're not alert. It's very dangerous. It's extremely dangerous. And of course, you know, are you a little too old for that? Okay. Okay. This is a great little educational tool that we reformatted and put together. The lady's great at this. Fabulous at doing these things for us, but it's obstructive sleep apnea and all the comorbidities. I mean, it's really unbelievable, everything. And you know, one thing I want to touch on, and all the forms that are out there for TMJ and sleep, the reason, if it's a specific sleep or TMJ form, the reason that they're asking about upper back pain, shoulder pain, neck pain on TMJ forms is a ton of TMJ people have all those pains. Okay? They have them. It's all part of it. It's all part of the TMJ syndrome. And so the mirror. the sleep appliance. Because when you don't get oxygen coming into your system, oxygen is a fuel. Burns off your calories when you're sleeping at night. So you lose weight. If you're trying to lose weight and you can't, there's a good chance you have a sleep issue. Because you're not getting oxygen that allows you to burn off your extra calories, whether it's during the day or at night. And actually the same patient, he got rid of diabetes. Because it's acquired. His system just, oxygen came in, burned up all this excess sugar, lost all this weight, boom, done, healed. Unbelievable. So anyway, what else? There's something else I wanted to say here. I'll wait for you. Okay. Here's another major issue we have in healthcare today, kids. Really a problem. And one of the big problems, there's a little slide later on we'll get into it, but there's a huge issue with ADD in our society today with children, ADD, ADHD. Everyone's on medication. I think there was something on 60 minutes, 6-8 months ago. They can't produce these ADD medications fast enough. There's a back order. It's like every kid has to have it. But the parents don't want to deal with their children, so they just drug them. It's really terrible. And a ton of them have a sleep issue. Large tonsils, large adenoids, something's wrong. Not every one of them, but a lot of them. And if you don't, and there's new standards that have come out in the last year, you know, the American Medical Association, the pediatric societies, on how pediatricians should be screening the kids in their practice for sleep issues. And I think if that really starts happening, you're going to see a big drop in the use of these drugs. So they have, these kids have small and normal jaws, they have large scalloped tongues, tonsils and adenoids, so these tissues block the airway, deviated septums, chronic sinusitis, allergies, and all usually mostly heavy. I was at a presentation one time, and this woman, I forget her name, she's really good, she's over in the Palisades somewhere. I'll think of her name in a minute. But she showed these cases where kids were in braces. And what these braces do, they put these big, thick arch wires over the bands. And what happens is that they're holding your jaw in a certain place, and the kid's trying to grow. Trying to grow, you know, it's an 8-9-year-old kid, 10-year-old kid, they're trying to grow. And these arch wires are holding their upper jaw like this. Well, the upper jaw is your airways, all your airways. You can't grow. And he's just not growing, he's short. He's 5-6 inches shorter than every kid in the school at his grade level. So they end up finding this woman in, like I said, the Palisades, and she says, this is his problem, get rid of these braces, let him grow, let him just do, and leave him alone. 5 months later, he's 2 inches taller than everybody. It was unbelievable, it just grew. And that was a couple of years ago, and at one of my biostatic conferences, it was an orthodontist from Denver spoke, and he had his adopted son, and the kid had just figured, hourglass, upper arch, really depressed, just horrible, crowded teeth, it was a real mess. Took him to the ENT, they had his turbinates removed, tonsils, adenoids. 6 months later, perfect arch form, no braces, just natural growth. So there's a lot of things that we're doing, we think we're doing the right thing, and it turns out we're really inhibiting kids from growing at their natural rates. We're hurting people. That's why I said ADHD and sleep. 50% of children, some form of nutritional medication, snoring, poor sleep, they stop breathing. And with kids, you don't have to have 10 or 15 of an issue. You can have 1, 2, or 3, it's an issue. Because you're trying to grow. So the standard in infants and children is much, much lower level to say you have apnea. And behavioral attention, large tonsils and adenoids. And what we do is, when we do have children sent to us, when I took I'll get into the appliances, DNA appliance with Dr. Dave Singh, but the point I'm trying to make is that there's two ways to approach this. You can make someone an appliance that's going to expand their maxilla and grow the upper dental arch and grow the airways, and that's going to work. But it doesn't deal with tonsils and adenoids. see what happens. Now, if they still have issues, now let's make the appliance and grow the maxilla. Because what happens is if I make the appliance first and I grow them, they're still going to have this. And this is blocking the airways. Well, if the air is blocked, I mean, I can open them up somewhat, but if you get rid of this, they're going to be that much better. So this is the first line that we do. We refer right to the pediatric ENT, and we get that taken care of first, and then if there's follow-up, then we do that. Okay, this is interesting. American Sleep Disorders Associated American Sleep Medicine. That with mild and moderate, put mild and moderate sleep apnea first line of defense. So that's up to 29 to 30 apneas an hour. You should try oral appliances first as opposed to CPAP if they have problems with CPAP. And then they further stay, which is this is what's really key also, specifically trained and experienced in overall health, temporal movement of joint, dental occlusion, and associated oral structures. The problem we have is, I think, is that there's a lot dentists are just making appliances, moving the jaw forward, creating occlusion, occlusal, and TMJ issues, and just telling the patient to stop wearing it, it'll go away, and there's nothing that can be done. But there are things that can be done. There are ways to help the TMJ get rid of the muscle pain and do certain things. Not every time, but you can do in a lot of cases. You can really progress them really, really slowly through their appliance. You can move them back. So you need an appliance that's really titratable. And the titratable appliances are relatively very expensive. The one that we use mostly is supplemental. And it's a tenth of a millimeter, an adjustment, which is really small. And we have people that it's like, yeah, I reached this point, and it started hurting, so I rolled it back one turn, and I'm like, pay my way. And, so we, and a lot of these appliances, they're rubber bands, or they're tubes, and everything's a millimeter or 2 millimeters, and that's way too, you're not going to get the same result, because you don't have the accuracy in the appliance. So we like using an appliance that really gives total accuracy. So and we spend a lot of time with our patients. I mean, when we deliver an appliance, we call them within the first day or two, they're back in the house in 3 days, they're back in the house in a week, 2 weeks, a month, 3 months, 6 months, and a year, checking and making sure that their symptoms are gone and they're healthy, they don't have any issues. So it's not just, you know, a simple couple impressions and out the door. Okay. Sleep apnea solution, I'm going to go through these one by one. I've already touched on all of them a little bit. But traditional CPAP, lovely. And they work. It's really the gold standard if you can deal with it. Extremely effective. But it's only positive thing you can say about this, it's effective. Oral appliances, when we use a Somnomed, we use it almost all the time. And you can, this screw, jack screw here, each turn's a quarter of a millimeter, one tenth of a millimeter. And you can actually turn it half turns if you want. So you can make it to a 20th. And we use the one, I think, like this, where there's no hooks. And it's a flexi rubber on the inside, it's really comfortable. Patients like it. Now, this is the one that is just starting to be used a little bit more. It's called the OPAM. And it's obviously a dual arch oral appliance with either a palatal pocket or it can have, you know, multiple slots through the front where it connects. But it hooks up the CPAP on a swivel, comes in. And the beauty of this is it's not adjustable. Jaw's not adjustable on this unless you remake it, so it can be pretty expensive to start making 2 and 3 foot people until they're comfortable. So you're not really treating them to their maximum jaw advancement or anywhere close to it. You're treating a maximum, you'll go as edge to edge, or maybe even a little less than that, since you don't want to remake this thing. And actually, everyone heard of 1-800 snoring? Some of the commercials? The guy that owns that company, and he actually lives in Tarzana, this is his. He came up with this idea, and it works really, really well. If someone is in mild or moderate sleep apnea, we make the Somnomed. If all the data, their air airways and all the data from the, all the exam, the x-rays and all that, say that's the right thing to do. If they're severe, we go with this. And the nice thing is, it's much more comfortable than traditional seatbelt with a mask or nasal cannulas or whatever else there is. That's number one. Number two, because you're moving the jaw forward somewhat, you're alleviating some of the blockage. And in fact, some of the blockage is relieved, and the jaws move forward, you can lower the pressure. So if they were using the CPAP at, you know, 12 or 14, you can probably lower it down to 6. So it makes it much more comfortable for the patient to have this combination of appliance. Okay, this is really exciting to me. I'm a dentist, but so it doesn't take much to excite me. But the DNA appliances, Dave's saying he's up in Portland, and the lab that a bunch of labs make, I mean, Arrowhead is where he wants you to go with it, because if you make it at Arrowhead, he probably gets $100. And if you go to the other labs, they don't make them as well. They're not as good, because they just, you know, anyway. So, but what makes this work to go from here to here? And what you really can't see is the palate's drop down. All the OS are larger. The pharynx is larger, left to right side, you know, from the lateral view and the front view. And what you're really doing here is, and one of the things that they do is they want you to move the lower jaw forward. It says here, see, the jaw is able to move forward in a more natural position. That's what they say. Now, I'm a TMJ guy, and the way I treat and I've been most successful with is moving the condyle into the socket, anterior superior position. They want you to move this down somewhat. And that's why I think it's a problem. So when I use this appliance, I keep the condyle in its anatomic ball and socket position, period. And I don't get the advancement that they get, but I get the expansion here. And what happens is, on kids it works really quickly. You know, you only do it quarter of a millimeter a week, one turn of the jack screw a week. But in adults, the growth is a little slower, it's harder, but they're all live stem cells in every age person. They've done autopsies in people 65, 70, 80 years old, and there's live stem cells in mid-suture. So you put pressure on it, you get the osteoclast and osteoblast go to work, and you get real bone formation. But, and so this whole thing is palatal coverage of teeth on a basket. So when you expand this screw, it's like this. You're bodily moving the posterior teeth. The posterior teeth aren't getting loose. And as you bodily move it, you actually have to adjust the internal surface of the appliance to allow your palate to drop. And back in here, too, you wake up one morning and you feel with your tongue go, I got that line, you know, at the edge of my mouth. The back of my throat's dropping. So then you have to cut this back and thin it. And you keep doing that. And you see the patient every, you know, 3-4 weeks. And you go from here to here. Yes?
So what happened to their occlusions?
Yeah. Good point. A lot. So a lot happens. So it isn't just an upper DNA, because now you're wider, and most people, the teeth did come together. So now you have to either go to some form of lower expansion appliance. They have lower DNAs. The DNA is really just these special wires, these springs that vibrate the teeth and whatever it does. And I'm not thrilled with even using those, unless you have to move a tooth. If the teeth are crooked across, you can use these to create the space correctly. But once you finish, the way that the sequence works here is you wear the upper DNA for 3 or 4 months. So you try to attain 3 to 4 millimeters of expansion that's measurable. Like I said, in adults, it's a lot slower. I have one of these appliances, and you'll see my cone beam. And I've worn it for 3 months with expansion, and I've only had about 1.5 millimeters in actual bone growth. So it's half as much as I should have, because I think the older you are, your body doesn't work as well as with kids. So once you expand the upper to a point where you're happy, just 3-4 millimeters, then you can get a lower appliance like this, or a lower Schwartzman, whatever it is, just expand the lower. And then you go back and retreat the upper for another couple 3 millimeters, because most people come in at 34. millimeters are 38, 39. And that's, the normal range is 38 to 42. First, mesolingual first molar. So you can go from upper to lower, back to upper, and then you evaluate the lower again. And there are a lot of people doing this that put people in banded braces for the final, you know, to get the final occlusion, get everything lined up. I use Invisalign. And I just use the upper tray and the Invisalign to stabilize the upper arch, expand the lower, and then when the lower is where I want it, I go back to the upper and go back to the Invisalign, go back and forth. I just do keep doing mid-course corrections. And it's very effective treatment. And it's really good with airways. There's one article out that Dr. Singh wrote that was a patient had 25 events, AHI of 25, and the post-op sleep test was at zero. Now the patient had small teeth from 6 to 11, so when they expanded everything, they had all these spaces, and they couldn't really regroup them. So they ended up doing veneers on them. The case looked really great. The guy who's sleeping better is off. He's off three out of four of his meds, and the one he wants to stay on, it's like a one half or a quarter of the dosage he was taking before. But he's breathing. He's able to breathe now. So it's definite, really good option. Okay, this is me. Yeah, that's me. Mm-hmm. And you can see I was 34.4, and my airway width was 22.5. And after 3 months, 35.8, 23.3. So I increased, and I know it's working because my wife tells me it's working. Because I don't have restless breathing anymore, and I hardly have a snore. And this is only really half of where I should be. Probably a third to a quarter where I will be when I'm finished. And you can see here, I have a pretty good size airway. These numbers. But so, it was still an issue for me. And it actually happened as I gained weight. Weight's a huge issue, especially in males. With women, maybe half the women that are a little overweight have an issue, but with men it's probably easily 90-95% range that have issues. And if I lost 10 pounds, I wouldn't have to do anything else. But as you get old, it's really hard. And I'm hoping that with my airways that they'll make it easier for me. Okay, I'm not going to read all this. You guys can read it. It's in the handout. But the important thing is what's happened in the last 3 or 4 months, maybe 4 or 5 months, all these people are coming in with TMJ. And, you know, they come with TMJ because they're in pain. They go to the dentist or the doctor. And I ask the question, how do you sleep? And I don't sleep, as I said earlier, I haven't slept in 20 years. I've been out in the bathroom 5, 6 times, blah, 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 blah. And then it comes back. Grinding your teeth, clenching, yeah, I clench, I do everything. Well, what's happened is the sleep bruxism, my theory, is there's a coexistence, and what they're doing is they grind to keep their muscles active in neck and face. Because if the muscles are active, they can't collapse and make your airway smaller when you're sleeping. I don't know, this is just my little thing I've thought of. And so they don't collapse, therefore the airways remain open, the patient can breathe. So they have a sleep issue to keep the airways open, and they get TMJ, which gives them pain finally, and then they come in. Because people don't voluntarily come in. A lot of people don't go to doctors or dentists unless they're in pain. Well, there's no real pain with sleep issues. You're fatigued, you know, you have all these other things, there's no pain. So they finally get pain. Bingo. And I probably have a dozen people in the last 3-4 months like this. And it's probably 3 out of 4 patients we've screened have this sequence. They have a dual syndrome. Okay? Where am I? Okay. Let's wrap this up. Okay. 12% of the population have TMJ disorder. just a food for thought for everybody. I really believe basically everybody has TMJ. It's just, what is it that is going to bring it to the surface? Is it an auto accident? Is it stress? Are you going to fall down? Are you going to get, you know, you're going to get hit by something? Whatever it is, it's there. Because how many people really have ideal occlusion, ideal jaw position, condyle in the socket, and your body right? It's not that very many. So I think everyone really has it. And it's just, what is it going to be that's going to tip you over the top? And after working with TMJ for close to 20 years and sleep for the last 8 or 9, this is what I see. And the other thing I see, to be honest with you, hope there's no orthodontist in the room, but 65% of our patients with TMJ have had orthodontic treatment. Another 10 or 15% had their third molars taken out while asleep. And the other ones either just have it genetically or some of them have dentistry that's actually caused it. You do the tech scan, and the occlusions are all on the crowns they had placed. You know? All the anesthesia defines all the crowns are in place correctly. So, with TMJ, you have all these symptoms, and one of the things that's not here is on the question they're always asking about neck, upper back, shoulder pain. And it's all associated with TMJ. If you have neck, upper back, and shoulder pain, it's probably TMJ. If your lower jaw's out of position, it pulls your head forward. When your head comes forward, this 16-pound ball pulls on all the muscles that are connected to the base of your skull. And then you refer pain. And I can tell many people that we've made appliances for and got their jaw to go to the right place, their head goes up a degree or two, bingo, all their neck, shoulder, upper back pain are gone. It's not golf. Why is it happening? What's the cause of these problems the patient's coming in with? And one of the things in dental school we're taught to say, oh, broken tooth, you know, onlay, crown, whatever. Why? Why did it happen? Now, in some people, the why is, it just happened. But what I see in the majority of people we treat, there's really a reason for it. There's something going on. There's a cause. That's not just the tooth broke. And, one of the things I could say, you have rain here in the desert, right? Okay, good. Well, if you come home, it's raining, and you go in your living room, and there's water coming down on your carpet, your floors, and the ceiling's falling in, you put a bucket there, what do? When the rain stops, you call the roofer, and he tells you, yeah, you have a big leak, you need a new roof, whatever, and you fix it. And then, because that's the cause of the problem. And then you fix your carpet, your flooring, your walls, everything's great again, and you took care of the problem. But what happens, because you're a dentist, don't take this wrong way, guys, ladies, but you go home and you have this problem, and when the rain stops, everything dries out, you go, oh, I'm just going to fix it. And you call the decorator and the roofer, you call your plasterer and your ceiling guy and your painter, and you fix everything, and the next time it rains, your ceiling falls down again. Because that's the way we're trained to do. We're trained to just fix. We're not trained to answer the why question. We go right from what's happening, what can we do about it? And it works really well with a lot of patients, but we all have patients that you fix things and they just keep breaking, keep falling apart. And those are the patients that really need a much more comprehensive approach. Okay. And here is the educational form we have for TMJ. That lady put together as a takeoff on our sleep form. All these are on our website, and I think we may have brought some. This is great. Snapple cap. See, there is some value in Snapple. A cat's lower jaw cannot move sideways. Same thing with a dog. A lot of animals. What do dogs and cats have in common their whole life? Anyone know? Through their teeth. Sharp teeth. They have sharp teeth their entire life because they're vertical chewers. They cannot chew laterally ever. The coronary process is inside the zygomatic process the entire time when they open and close. And that's one of the things Bob Lee realized, as I said earlier, is this verticalized occlusion. All the people with the best teeth have verticalized occlusion with a reasonable amount of overgen overbite. And that's why this is really important. That's a why. This tells it right there. Just like with sleep. No bottles, no pacifiers. You put a nipple, a mother puts a nipple on a baby's mouth, it's this small. It goes in the baby's mouth and just totally flattens out and spreads, and you get this big, wide, flat palate. It's not great for dentures down the road, but they'll breathe really well as they lose all their teeth, okay? So it's real important. Okay, tooth wear. Here, and even this little bit, you notice the occlusion here is on the first bicuspid. And this isn't, so, I've seen patients that their canines are worn past the point of touching. There's a half millimeter, millimeter space. Well, if this is touching here, how can that hit? They're going in some parafunctional move to grind that down. This patient too, all things ground down. This is interesting. Anyone know Trevell and Simmons? Two, double volume book, upper body, lower body. All the trigger points, every muscle. It's a huge book. I just look at the pictures. But one of the things, the vast majority, not in every case, but the X is the trigger points, and in most instances, the pain is referred up. It's either lateral or up in all these places. So all these pains are from the muscles. So all this head pain, eye pain. And here's neck, look at this. Sternocleidomastoid. Look at that pain. All up. Everything, forehead pain. See? This is an amazing book. Just to look at. And how's this? See? Neck and shoulder pain? It's all head posture. And head posture is a ton of head posture that has to do with jaw position. Okay, real quickly, just anatomy of the joint, real simple. I forget, this is Hingston. We just photocopied these off the, these are really big boards that we show patients every occasionally when we photocopy them. But it just shows normal jaw position, anterior superior, biconcave disc. And this is starting the movement. And then full opening. The rectusal tissue, everything is lined up real well. Problem, this is the posterior part of the disc, the flash is the bulge. Now it's in front of the condyle. And that's how you get popping. When you open, it pops over that bulge and it flies back into the right position. And that's what popping is. So clicking and popping is really the first sign of an issue. If you have popping and clicking in your joint, you have TMJ. And it's only when and if you live long enough, is when is it going to come back and bite you? And here it is when it's closed, and you see, you have permanent displacement here, which means the condyle is on that retrocondylar distal tissue, and that's when people come in with stabbing pain. It really hurts. And these people a lot of times need injections, which I don't do anything I send out for that. I just do non-invasive appliance TMJ. But what we do here is, here's the ear hole. We'll have the patient open as wide as they can, palpate in the ear. And if they have pain with a pinky finger palpating in there, that's that tissue right here. Very serious issue. And then, of course, bone breakdown and disc perforation if it gets bad enough. Oh, let's see if you can play this, sorry. It's a nice little software. We play for our patients occasionally. Lately's really good at that, so is Maria.
I think the audio is wrong.
Audio?
Let me double check that. You might want to pause it, Dr. Gorman.
Pause it. Biosuit.com if you're really interested. And it just shows that when a patient opens it as an incorrect bite, the muscles send messages to our brain and the brain knows where the teeth are. So no matter how good or bad your bite is, your teeth are going to come together the best way, the least invasive, most comfortable way for yourself. So you're not going to bang into your teeth. But what happens is patients with TMJ is that they usually have a posterior bite interference. So they would normally hit, like in this picture right here, you hit back here. But what happens is your brain doesn't want you to have that pain or break a tooth, which is really uncomfortable. So it just slides your jaw forward, and so your teeth can fit together in the most comfortable way possible. But then your muscles are all doing a ton of extra work. And that's when you get muscle spasm, muscle pain. I mean, if you open this door here, if it was jammed, warped, and you had to open and close it, and you were the muscle, and you're going back and forth like that four or 5,000 times a day, you're gonna be on your ass on the floor out here. All muscles the same way, they get fatigued. And that's why it's important for the joint, the TMJ, to be stable in one position. And if it opens and closes in the exact same arc, or very close to the exact same arc every time, now you know where to put the teeth. When you hang a door, the carpenter sets the hinges, puts the door on, sands the door down so it opens and closes perfectly, then he puts the lock on the teeth, the last thing he does. So if you have issues with patients where things are breaking, it's because of the joint. I mean, how many times have we made a temporary crown or a second molar? A patient came in with a denture with a tooth missing. And they come back 2 weeks later or 2 days later with a denture or their crown, and you go to put it in and the bite's done. My denture doesn't fit anymore. The bite's off. Well, the condyle settled. Well, they were gone. It's out of the socket. Or the temporary. If you don't have an occlusal stop there, that jaw can move. And that's why we're grinding like crazy on second molars to get them to fit. The jaw's moving. Okay.
Just X out of that. You can just X out of that up there.
Up here?
On the computer, yeah.
Oh, on the computer, okay. What I do, which is very different, I think at the schools they teach internal, external. I do acute and chronic. Recent trauma, stress, and that kind of chronic is just more severe. And the thing that we have found that's really exciting is we do great jobs on people with migraines, especially if they have headaches first, and then the headaches lead to a migraine. Because in the vast majority of instances, the headaches are TMJ, muscle pain, the way the jaw's moving. So if we cut out the TMJ issue, migraines aren't triggered. We're very, very successful cutting off the headaches, and then the migraines stop. We have patients that have come in that have 5 and 6 migraines a week, and now they're down to 1 or 2 a year. I mean, it's a total life change. It's really fabulous to help people like that. Okay. Here are the 3 ways, real quickly, to adjust what we do with TMJ solutions. Sorry. We have the tech scan, bite adjustment. We use that bite analysis and marking paper. And sometimes you need bonding if the teeth are worn down. It could be bonding, it could be veneers, whatever it takes to reestablish a proper occlusal scheme. And then you have the NTI with the bite adjustment bonding. So it's either the NTI or the tech scan. And then the MAGO, which is the maxillary anterior guide orthotic. And that's bite adjustment bonding and restorative normally. And this is really for the more major patients. The severity of the symptoms and the severity of the kitchens of the teeth, as they get worse, we 10 down to this way. So if it's real, something really easy, simple, something that looks really good, has minimal issues, we try to do it this way, and then the second way would be here, and the amount of time, effort, and expense increases as you get on the list. So with a text scan, goes in the patient's mouth, they squeeze, we get the readings, and what I said earlier, we use 8-micron thick marking papers, very, very thin. And then I said 5% on each side, that's 45-55. That's your goal to get there or within that limit. And the sequence of treatment, because you haven't put the patient in any kind of appliance. So what we're doing is, when we adjust them on day one, the condyle is nowhere near seated, probably. So we see them in a week, and then at the end of 30 days, we have people coming in between. So my bite's really off, you have to help me. So we take care of it, feels great, and they come back, and where do they? Yeah, it feels so much better, because the condyle just took a huge movement, and it got up in the socket, and now it's close to stable. But there are some, the typical patient is four and a half visits to do it this way. But it has to be but the constant change is the issue here, because we haven't stabilized the condyle with any treatment, with any appliance every first. So the only thing we're doing, we're adjusting the bite, and every time we adjust the bite, the mandible moves and all the teeth move with it, and then you get changing for the 30, 40 days. We have one patient that, Bonnie, I mean, she's come back probably 6 times we've adjusted her bite. And she'd been good for 2.5-3 months at a stretch. Then all of a sudden, boom, she has a little relapse. And we make really minor adjustments. Two seconds, 2-3 little zip zips. Oh, it feels great now, thanks. And she disappears for 4-6 months. And then she comes back with a little issue. And her sister has the same issue, went to somebody else, and they made her upper lower flat appliances, two of them. They said, you have to wear these the rest of your life, or get a full month reconstruction. And I did this tech scan and a bite adjustment. So, I mean, there's a lot of variations, and we're always looking, to be honest with you, we're always looking for the least invasive, least expensive way to treat a patient. Okay, number two, the NTI. It's really a great little device if it's used correctly. We only use it on the upper. We never use it anyplace else. We like the moving part going to the fixed part. There's a reason for it. I wish I could tell you what it is, but I can't remember what the reason is. But it's a very valid reason, and I've tried lower appliances and adjusting them the same way I adjust the upper or backwards, and it never works. I've only had success with upper appliances. And what happens is we keep the patient 7, 10, 12 days, whatever it takes to get them comfortable. And every time they take this out, their bite feels different. So we have them wear it before they come to the office. And I take it out, tech scan, put it back in. They bite, squeeze their teeth together, can't touch with the NTI in. We mark it, the 8-micron paper. And we use the paper and the tech scan to show us where to adjust. Now this is quicker. And we keep going in and out with the NTI to reestablish the proper arc, take it out, tech scan, mark the paper, and adjust. And we adjust with basically muddle, usually upper distal from the lower. So it comes from the mesial on the upper teeth, comes from the distal on the lower teeth, and finally everything touches. And we send them home, and this is a quicker adjustment, because the condyle is seated at least somewhat. But all you have here is protrusive, you don't have any of the left and right shifts. So it's not as ideal as the MAGO, which is what I learned from Bob Lee in bioesthetics. And the crazy thing, this, we were taught to make this appliance before any time we were going to store people that had major issues with severe wear, or people that are always breaking teeth and crowns and they had just issues. We would do this to stabilize their condyle, get everything lined up right so it open and close the same way every time, so we know where to rebuild the teeth. Whether it was two veneers bonding and a crown, or it was a full reconstruction, whatever your treatment plan was, we did this first. And something clicked in me really early in the program, so I was pretty lucky. And what I ended up doing was, I ended up making 40 or 50 of these on my patients in my practice, because the course was basically 19 or 20 times going to San Francisco for 2 to 4 days, over 2.5 years. So it was very long, very intense, very detailed program, and I realized this was really the key, was to stabilize the condyle if I really want. be successful in my dentistry. So I made 40 or 50 of these on patients, whoever would let me make it. I charged $100 for it, I don't care. I just wanted to get experience doing it, get rid of my learning curve. So I did, and when I went back, I realized every patient with headache, facial pain, neck pain, minor popping and clicking, everything went away. So I said, this isn't an occlusal appliance, it's a TMJ appliance. So that's when I started doing TMJ, when I learned how to use this appliance in 93 and 94. And I had taken all the classes at SC and UCLA from all the TMJ people, and they teach something totally, totally different. Okay? And we're successful 85 to 90% of the time with our TMJ patients, which, I don't know. I think that's really a good number to be at. And what we do is, it's the most successful treatment modality because we treat for 2 to 3 months usually. It could be up to 6 months, but the typical patient's 2 to 3 months, 15 to 20 visits. So it's a lot of chair time. And we're changing, adding acrylic, modifying the appliance to idealize the patients. But a lot of people get out of pain within the first 3, 4 days, a week, 10 days. But the jaw's still moving. They may be at an 80, 85% seated position, but if we keep treating them, as their jaw heals and the inflammation goes down and the fluid gets taken out of the body, out of the area, the jaw keeps moving. So there's a lot of compensation going on in our bodies. That's why they're out of pain in, like I said, 3 days to a week, 10 days, but the jaw's still moving for 2, 3, 4 months. So that we don't finish treatment until the jaw stops moving. So this is the more severe cases. And then we adjust. It's 2, 3 days in a row, and that's it. Because you've done all the work in the appliance. So when you transfer it to the teeth, it's accurate. Rarely is there an issue with people coming back or noticing anything. Until I got the text scan. And then we found some issues. But nothing the patients noticed, and they had no pain. It was just an improvement using the text scan. Here's somebody that we've treated, and we haven't seen her in about, I don't know, 8, 9 months. She was moving back to New York. Her husband's got a job with World Wrestling, whatever it is. He got this great job, got promotions for them. He's making a ton of money. So he moved to Connecticut. He says, Doc, I'm coming back. You're the only one's ever helped me. I'm going to fly back every 6 weeks, blah, 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 blah. Then a month later, she comes in and goes, I'm pregnant. I can't, I'm moving back. I can't fly for a year. So I transferred her a buddy of mine in New York that knows how to do this. But what we did, this is how she came in. And it's hard to see in this picture, and I can't remember which side, to be honest with you, but she said, my bite's off. Her previous dentist said, I'll fix that for you. So we adjusted one side, the second molars. All she had was second molar occlusion on both sides. So we took on one side, just cut away the lower second molar. So now she's just hitting on the left second molars instead of the right second molars. I was like, okay. So she came in, we made her the mago. Completely got it. She came with stabbing pain, but really lucky. Got the jaw in a really healthy place. She has no more pain, no discomfort, everything's fabulous. And then she moved, but before she moved, what we did was, the second one, and what we do, before we do a case like this with a mago, we actually take a centric bite, put it on the articulator, and actually see where are we gonna adjust on these teeth. So I knew going in that her second molars were really, really, really out of position. And what I did is when we numbed her, I prepped them, made her temporary crowns, temporary onlays on her second molars, put them with permanent cement, and we balanced her bite down to here, did a little bit of bonding on the canines to give her some guidance. And what happened was she couldn't tolerate on this side. So I took her away, oh, I feel so much better, so we'll try again, maybe, and then she took off. But she's with my buddy, we closed it down from here to here, and then before she left, we actually put her in a DNA. Because I said, I think you may have sleep apnea, and she just laughed at me. But she finally condoned to go to take a sleep test, and she came back with mild sleep apnea. It's not she thinks I'm a genius. I fooled someone else. So, but the point is, we made her an upper DNA, and she's in that now, because we want to widen her out a little bit. And in the process of that, we will, myself and my buddy Jeff in New York, will bring these down. And give her the anterior guidance and get everything finished up. It's a very interesting case. Okay, in summary, emerging new technology with health questionnaires and assessment to get a patient's healthy status, get an accurate diagnosis, and it allows healthcare professionals to stimulate awareness, successfully address and treat sleep disorders and TMJ disorders in their respective practices. So it's a real plus. It's been a fabulous addition to our practice, the new technology. It's really just changed what we do on a daily basis. And this is my team, almost one missing. And she's twice that size now. She's having a baby in a couple weeks. That's me. That's Nancy, who's about 25, 26 years. There's Laylee, AJ, Ellie, and Maria. And Sandra, the hygienist, is working in the back, I guess. Kind of like but anyway, thank you all very much. A pleasure. Do you need anything? It's on our website. You can pick it up or you can call. And we can get you anything you'd like to have. All right. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Nice work. That was a pretty heroic collaborative effort there to get.
Oh, I know. That was fast. That was quick. That's the quickest work I've seen. Very impressive.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You're very welcome. That worked well. That was
fast. Aaron, so you heard him speak. What did
you say? Oh, yeah. Oh, and
long day.
We saw him.
Yes. Alex, you're going to be 14.
Took a stir.
So when you say long days, yeah, the days are longer than years are short.
Funny how that works.
Isn't it weird?
Oh, yeah.
And he's like a massive program. This last summer.
We would have heard all the work. They changed
him. Well, I was lying. I was 60.
From the way he was doing it.
Really?
I don't know.
So I was in the second group.
I'm thinking yesterday was my mom's birthday. She turned 80. I may have to call her back and ask her if I was really born in 53.
Sure.
He was really a great guy.
Yeah, I mean, that's
great.
Unfortunately,
I feel exercise. I definitely get better.
So it takes a special. Why you said special?
So I just form up. I went, you know, to give him your
staff
to be pressed in right behind your practice. And so I went
started taking
an airplane back
Dr. Bass.
And cruise down there.
Yeah, cruise on the beach.
Yeah.
screws around. We have a little dog. She puts the dog, had a basket put on the front. She puts the dog in the basket. We just ride for a mile around in the country. No traffic.
And it's nice too because the hills are very steep.
Yeah, no, very. Just a good excuse to get your legs and we'll start.
See what we do. His example is what it really is a big NTI. I mean, NTI probably, he probably got the idea for this. But when I first day, only a level 14 to touch the plastic. No canines, no canine contact in CR, no canine contact in lateral, no posterior tooth contact. So in lower teeth, the appliance is here. It's just these four. All the back teeth, everything is separate. All the muscles relax. Condyle moves into this, into the side of the same position. That's what happens. The muscles just take it. And then you keep adjusting the appliance until the markings on these four teeth up here, the way they're supposed to look. And they come back a couple visits in a row. And we are the same. You know they're stable. Now you've got the plastic and the lateral guidance. And you start another adjustment.